There's a lot of careers and industries out there where you have to work for years in order to secure the bag. You got to start at the bottom, work your way up, and that might take years. But these careers that we're talking about today are going to be ones where you can go right into an entry-level position right after college, or even in some cases, you don't need schooling at all. So number 10 on the list is going to be a software developer. Also known as a coder, this is somebody who creates computer software. And software is basically the programming and operating information that someone can use in order to tell a computer how to work. Now, one interesting thing to note about software development, and I'm just going to be blunt here, it's kind of a young person's game. The average age of a software developer in the United States, for instance, is about 32 years old. To put that in perspective, the average age of a lawyer, for instance, in the US is going to be around 50. Now, there are several different ways for you to become a developer. Getting a computer science degree would be one of them, of course. You can also go to coding boot camps. You can take online classes. Now, this is one where you can go right into it and make pretty good money, and then there's even more opportunity beyond that to make like really, really good money. You can check out websites like levels.fyi if you want to see what some of these companies in Silicon Valley, Seattle, and New York are paying some of their software developers. There's developers at Facebook, for instance, that are making over $1 million a year, although that is pretty rare. The big point here is technology and specifically software development, learning how to code. I think this is a huge opportunity. Very, very valuable skill to learn. It's pretty future-proof in my opinion as well, because sure, there's going to be a lot of things that are automated, but you're going to be the one who is programming those things that automate. The real number 9 is going to be systems engineering. Now, it's kind of hard to explain what systems engineers do, but basically they take the whole system of, let's say, a product lifecycle, for instance, and they figure out what each individual part needs to do. So they design, integrate, and manage complex systems over their lifecycle. So not only are you going to be using your engineering expertise, but it's also kind of a business-related degree as well. Engineering degrees are really, really difficult. A lot of people go into engineering and they end up dropping out. It has one of the highest dropout rates out of any type of major. That's actually one reason why I don't rank engineering degrees as high, just because of the fact that the average person probably isn't going to want to put themselves through engineering school that 4 years, which a lot of the time turns into like 5 or 6 years because of how difficult it is. And sometimes it's not even about how smart you are. I mean, I'm sure most of you guys watching this are smart enough to get an engineering degree, but a lot of it is just hard work. Most of them just studied all the time. Like they didn't really have a life. When it was finals time or midterms, these guys, they'd come out of their little study caves and they'd have like, you know, black rings around their eyes looking like a raccoon. But if you're big brain, you're really passionate about the subject, you can definitely do it. Now this particular one, systems engineering, it's kind of like a mixture of a project manager and an engineer. Let's say it's a car, for instance. Then you got a team of electrical engineers and computer engineers that are going to be working on the hardware within the car. Then you got a team of software engineers that will be working on the software that they're going to use in the car. And then you've got the system engineers that make sure all of them are on the same page and the project moves forward as it should. Now, this requires a ton of technical knowledge and also a lot of business savvy. The skills that you can learn from this career would be skills that businesses would love to have in the future, even if they're a little bit unrelated. So this is one where by default, you're probably going to end up working in a management position eventually, but it also pays really well right off the bat. Number 8 on the list is going to be a Java developer. So Java developers are a specialized type of coder, and generally they're going to work with web developers and software engineers. So they're going to go ahead and implement Java into different websites, software, as well as applications. Now Java is very common, and because of that, a lot of people choose to specialize in it. And I'm not going to lie, this one is pretty dang spicy to specialize in, okay? Now, like I mentioned for a moment before, when it comes to coding, there's generally two ways for you to progress in your career. The first one is to move towards more of a leadership or a project management role. And then the second is to specialize in something and gain extreme technical expertise. So basically, you're like the master. You know, if you learn these languages, you get really good at them. There's just a ton of opportunity out there. And I would sit there just like memorizing just like pages and chapters and books of medical information, thinking to myself, maybe I should have went into coding instead. So yeah, anyways, Java can be a really good one for you to gain technical expertise in, so I'm not surprised that it was mentioned. Number 7 on the list is going to be an implementation consultant. So basically, in layman's terms, what they do is, let's say you're working for a software company and they just sold a huge project to a single hospital, okay? So they sold some electronic software to a hospital. Now, it's probably part of an entire hospital network, but they're gonna try it out at that one hospital first, see if they like it, and then if they like it, they're going to go ahead and do it at every single hospital, and it's gonna be like a huge contract, millions and millions of dollars. So it's very important for the company to make sure that that software gets rolled out very, very efficiently. So I'm sure a lot of people watching this before have had to learn a new software before. It's a huge headache, especially if there's a lot of bugs or anything like that. And so what implementation consultants do is they would work for the software company and they would go to that hospital while it's being rolled out, and they would be there to not only install everything, but get everybody trained up and make sure that all the bugs or anything like that, all of that is taken care of. They'll talk to the IT department, the hospital management, they'll talk to the doctors, the nurses, the pharmacists. They'll make sure that everyone is on the same page. They'll take care of all the different glitches, hangups, any questions that anybody has. If there are any bugs in the system, they'll make sure that they get fixed, and they will stay at the hospital as long as they need to in order to roll out the software. Now, as you can see from a company's perspective, this is an extremely useful position to have. Very cool career, very useful. Number 6 on the list is going to be UX designer. Now, the UX stands for the user experience. You also hear them referred to as UX, UI designers, user experience, user interface. So what they focus on is the user experience, you know, users like you and I, and their interaction with different types of technologies like websites, applications, cars, for instance. So people with this skill set are supposed to be able to wear many different hats. Now, most of them are going to have an emphasis on software development, of course. So let me give you an example here. Have you ever used like a government website or just a website that's really badly designed? It's almost impossible for you to figure out where everything is. It's like you're just trying to do one thing and you can't figure out how to do it. This sort of thing actually kills businesses, and a lot of them aren't even aware of it. So they would think about, okay, if a person is on this web page on this website, what are they likely to be looking for? How can I make what they're most likely to be looking for as obvious as possible so that they can get to it? So this is another career that's very creative, but it's also pretty practical. So if you're someone who's very artistic, this could be a good one for you to look into. It's gonna be especially interesting to see how it evolves with the onset of touch interface, voice control, augmented reality, virtual reality. Very interesting field. Number 5 on the list is going to be a product designer. And this one is basically all about imagining, designing, and creating products that are meant for mass production. So you want to make them as beautiful, aesthetic, and ergonomic as possible, but you also want to keep in mind the practical side of things and make sure that it's a product that can be mass produced. So this could be anything from designing beautiful chairs to designing a futuristic Cybertruck with bulletproof windows. Number 4 on the list is going to be an investment banking analyst. So basically, you are going to be analyzing different investment banking criteria, and then you're going to be making a bunch of different presentations and giving advice and guidance to investment bankers. Another career where you have a very nice salary right off the bat with an entry-level job. Some investment banks take the strategy of just hiring the smartest people possible. They're basically going purely for brain power. Their strategy is to hire people who graduate from majors like math and physics and engineering, and basically they think that if they just hire the smartest people in the world, all of the problems will kind of just work themselves out. So they want to hire smart people and then train them how to do investment banking. Whereas some of the other companies want to hire people who are already trained how to do investment banking, you know, accounting majors and finance majors, and they think that they're a little bit more specialized to do it. Now, one thing to note here is the hours, especially when you first start, are going to be very long and hard. There's a ton of money in the finance industry, and if you want to be able to work your way up to the top levels, you are going to have to work hard. You're gonna have to prove yourself most of the time. A lot of the time these jobs are gonna have like a base pay, and then there's gonna be some incentive bonus structure worked in there. Now, one really cool thing about this job and just the finance industry in general is there's pretty much no ceiling to how much you can make. I think finance is one of those things where it's very high risk and high reward, and they can make over $5 million a year. I'm not even kidding here. So this one can be really great for certain personality types, people who don't mind working like 80 plus hours a week, working super hard, and they're okay with doing that for many, many years before they get to the point where they can have more of a normal job. Number three on the list is going to be product manager. Now, this is a very interesting career. So basically what a lot of businesses do, especially big ones, is they'll have product managers that are almost like the CEO or the entrepreneur of that one product that the umbrella business is starting. So you're going to want to know what market you're targeting. What product is the problem solving? How is the product going to be marketed? What is the launch strategy? They're responsible for assembling different teams. You're going to have like, you know, the marketing team and the engineering team and then the software development side. And they're going to be responsible for making sure that everyone's communicating with each other and they're meeting the deadlines. Now, all these things are going to be the responsibility of the product manager. I think this is a great career in general. It teaches you leadership. It teaches you all kinds of different skills that are very valuable. I don't think this one will ever be automated. And I think this one is even better if you think you might want to become an entrepreneur in the future. This is almost like training wheels for learning how to start your own business. This is also one of the most common careers people go into after getting an MBA. With this career, you're going to have to learn how to wear many different hats. You're going to have to learn management, leadership, sales, marketing, all kinds of different things. You're going to have to be pretty good in every single one. Number two on the list is going to be a software engineer. Hey, another technology related career. What do you know? So software engineers, all the time they get confused with computer programmers or software developers. Think about it like this. Let's say you're designing a house. You're going to have an architect, which would be more like the software engineer, who designs the house itself, make sure that it's stable, make sure it's not gonna blow over, make sure it's got a good foundation. If there's an earthquake, it's not gonna collapse on itself and all that good stuff. Then you've got the contractor who actually builds out the house itself. That would be more like the software developer. They're the ones who actually write the code. So that's the difference between the two. Software engineers probably know a lot of code themselves. There is some overlap there, of course, but overall software engineering is an excellent one to get into. Number one on the list is going to be a data scientist. So data scientists in general are going to be employed by businesses. They're going to have some business expertise in order to analyze different data that can help the business make more money and be more successful. So basically, as a data scientist, you're gonna get a bunch of junk numbers that really don't make any sense, and you're gonna have to make sense of those numbers, figure out what you can glean, what you can tell from those numbers, and how your findings can actually help the business. Now, this is usually gonna be data that has something to do with either sales or marketing. You could say this is another degree that combines business skills with technology skills, which is always a good combination. So basically, what you're gonna do is take a bunch of crappy, unorganized data, and you are going to organize it in such a way that not only does it make sense, but you can make business decisions based on it, and you can explain it to the business people who might not be as technically talented. So this will require not just coding and problem-solving skills, but also a lot of math and statistics as well.